all for coming. We really appreciate it. Our third Thursday lecture series, and while we're going to give introductions in a minute, we do have a couple of announcements. I don't know if anybody saw anything last Friday come out of the news internationally. The Muscatelli Museum.
Yeah.
I said, like, look, the announcement of the Botticelli exhibition on Friday. Went pretty much viral both in the electronic social media, and pretty much hit all of the big, you know, art news websites and things like that. I don't know if you all, did you guys hear about this?
Yeah.
It wasn't the local papers though. At least you made that. But there was a very interesting quote, and the quote was that this is the largest and most important exhibition ever organized on Botticelli, and that was the cultural attaché Renato Morocco at the Italian Embassy in Washington. I don't think that's anything to sneeze at. And we have to thank the staff for working so hard, and for Dr. Spike, as you all know, who's been so often at these third Thursdays. Do not fear. John will give the last one on the next third Thursday, and it will be about Botticelli and the search for the divine, the title of the exhibition. So, you know, it's hard when we work on things like this for a couple of years, and you can't say a word to anybody. Because, you know, you're about to bust, and, you know, as it gets closer, sometimes we let a little few things leak out here or there, but to make a full announcement, we just received things from all over the country of kudos about how we once again have outdone ourselves. And so, it can make you a little tired trying to outdo yourself all the time. Names like Michelangelo, Leonardo, Caravaggio, and now Botticelli. Botticelli was friends with Leonardo and Michelangelo. And so if you just can imagine Florence with just these three guys, and it's pretty amazing. And beyond this, this exhibition is going to have the teacher of Botticelli, Filippo Lippi. It's going to have Botticelli's main and best pupil, Lippi's son, Filippino Lippi. There are rare works by Palaiuolo. Try saying that, it's hard to spell Palaiuolo. Jacopo Salaio. These were people, you know, working in Florence, and it's about this time from basically the apex of the Medici, the death of Lorenzo the Magnificent, until the onslaught of Savonarola. And if you haven't heard about the bonfires of the Vanities, sometimes it's made its way to us through literature, but it actually happened. There were at least two instances of fires where Botticelli paintings were thrown upon them, along with other aspects of luxury, decadence, and stuff that Savonarola was preaching against. And in fact, Lorenzo's son had so messed up Florence that they basically drove the Medici out. But living under such a heavy, heavy ascetic hand wasn't fun. So Savonarola himself was burned on the Piazza Marker there. They were rough back in those days. I think you all have heard me announce that we have a donor for the new, whatever a new wing of the museum would be. That came out of the last Board of Visitors meeting. What we do at the next DOV meeting is have a big announcement on the person naming the entire Center for the Visual Arts, and we're hoping we have enough paperwork done to be able to announce the architect for the project, and this was something that we're extremely proud of. Know that we're going to get a building, and our only, we had no caveats other than it has to be inspirational and it has to work as a museum, but we have no idea architecturally the possibilities. We've seen various compelling possible schemes and whether that will work or not, but to think that not only this town, but the college can have a building designed by one of the top five architects in the world is simply amazing. So give yourself a round of applause. So one more thing. The Botticelli show will go upstairs. And believe me, the docents are getting fired up, visitor services, the friends, the staff, the museum, and volunteers, because when you have the numbers of people coming like we had for the Leonardo show last year, it's an embarrassment of riches, but it's very taxing to realize you're open every day and every night of the week with special tours and these kinds of things. And so there are so many folks that work so very hard, and it's just not you all know, the docents that are here, the friends, what it was like day in and day out here. We're not complaining, it's just amazing the challenge. But there also is another opportunity. You remember during the Michelangelo show, downstairs we had the great Mattia Preti exhibition, big giant Baroque pictures. First exhibition ever organized in America, the foremost scholar of Caravaggio. What we got a lot was, you know what, that show downstairs was no slouch. So we decided to use that in a space that we can now control downstairs. So you're going to see an exhibition in this gallery of five, perhaps six now, paintings that the Muscarelli has absolutely stolen from the art market. I mean, stolen because they've been so wrongly cataloged, they're so long misunderstood, wrong century, wrong nationality. And so it's a connoisseurship show. It's the kind of art history I was taught by my old professor, Miles Chappell, who's sitting in the back. He hates when I say old professor. But Miles and John and people like myself, we try to impart to our students what connoisseurship is. And so down here, you'll have a single, maybe you'll have a work, and then you'll have a bunch of reasons why we believe it is what it is, from scientific evidence to other aspects of things. And so it's also a way to tutor our own work. Say, wait, we have in the past 2 to 3 years acquired works by some great, great names. And then in the small gallery, we're taking another step, and that will be also newly acquired old master prints, simply the kind of great, great prints a teaching museum must have that we hadn't had before. You know, we have 3 Rembrandts now. We just have some fantastic, wonderful, high-quality old master prints, and I figure while people are waiting down here to go upstairs, you might as well see what the fruits of all of our labors have been besides simply just the Botticelli show. So, and that's a little odd to say simply just the Botticelli show. I'd like to recognize EDB. We have a number of the folks from the bank here tonight. As you know, this is about this maybe five and a half years of EDB supporting the Muscarelli in the Third Thursday Lecture Series in a community partnership like we have. They provide the nice reception outside. The weather's still beautiful to be able to have that. And so they're going to make a small presentation as they do when we're out at the reception. But thank you so much to EDB for participating and being here tonight and for supporting such a high-quality branded program as the Muscarelli Third Thursdays. You've heard me say this many, many times, that the first Tuesdays and Third Thursdays aren't just sort of clever little twists of the tongue, but in fact, they're very high-quality branded programs where you don't even have to know what the numerical day of the date is. At 6 o'clock on the first Tuesday of the month and the third Thursday, you can be here for a compelling and engaging lecture of diverse topics. So thank you very much. I'm going to introduce Danielle Moretti-Weinholz, who's a professor in the anthropology department. She's also our adjunct curator of Native American art, to introduce Dr. Bowers.
In British art, 1700 to 1840 is perfect for for what we are going to think about upstairs and what's in town presently, and in 2014, her book, George Catlin, American Indian Portraits, are also both important contributions to the study of this topic. Stephanie, thank you for coming all the way from the UK to be with us tonight. Dr. Stephanie Brown.
Some of the first and earliest images we have of someone who saw Native Americans. He looked at them, he worked with them, he spoke with them. And some of the scientists, the quasi-pseudoscientists that went with John White, were learning Algonquin language so that they could translate. And they were taking Algonquin people back and living in Raleigh's house. So there was a whole community of people studying the Algonquin people. So these drawings come out of an attitude, a visual culture, an attitude the English had at that time, that art was a tool that you could use to study Native Americans. So it's kind of anthropological. It's kind of that, let's record what we see. But when we look at these images, there are things that maybe don't quite work or don't quite gel. And one of them, I don't know if you can guess it, looking at the man on the left, is there something funny about him? Do you think something that doesn't quite ring anthropologically? It's this wonderful pose, which you may all you may all see this pose, and you may see it again and again and again. It's called the Renaissance Elbow from Bronzino and from that era of mannerism. And in fact, John White was trained with a mannerist sensibility from the Flemish engravers. So there are lots of these crossover points, and I'm talking about that visual culture, that broad area where images talk to images. But, and this is a huge proviso, John White was there. He saw the indigenous people. He had captives. There were captives, Manteo and Moches, and they were brought to England. So he was around indigenous people. So he got to study their features. He got to speak with them. He got to look at them. So there is an element that we want to believe John White. We want to believe that he was accurate. And we want to, as anthropologists, as forensic scientists, see something in these images that help us understand their involvement. So I want us to also hold that in our minds as we go through. But what we have with all Native American images, almost all of them, is a play between anthropology and science, the study of the Native American, and the symbolic, romantic Native American. And those two play against each other in almost every image. Because what people want to do is they want to make an image that works. They want to make an image that tells a story, that gives information. But they're artists, and they are going through their training. They're going through the way they do bodies, the way they draw. Their masters and who taught them. They were taught in workshops. So John White's training as a limner, as a watercolor specialist, meant that he concentrated on the face. So if you look at Algonquin faces, you may find some reality in John White, because that's what his training was, to study faces. Now, when you look at the bodies, you're going to see the Renaissance elbow and the Renaissance gentlemanly pose. So what we have here is some Brazilian family engraved for Jean Galeri's voyage made to Brazil in 1578, so it was before John White in 1585, and then an allegorical image of the American continent. And you can see how both of those images feed in. But what's really, really interesting, I find this so interesting, is Hendrik Goltzius's Standard Bearer of 1587. This is just 3 years, just around the time John White is studying and doing his Native American poses. And what he does is he chooses a standard bearer pose, the Renaissance elbow, the holding of the standard. But if you read the Latin inscription on Goltzius, it says, "I, the standard bearer, bestow great courage and daring. The line holds while I stand firm, but were I to flee, it would break and run." And kind of an interesting undercurrent, if you think about Native Americans being standard bearers for English Empire and English desires, colonial desires. If we hold the Indians, we stand firm. If we let the Indians fly, we lose. And it's so interesting that John White's drawing is called The Flyer. And so it's this contrast between Native Americans that we can understand, that we can hold on to, that we can be friends with, and Native Americans who don't work with us, who are maybe untrustworthy. So there's that that element that they don't understand Native American people yet, and maybe never will. But the first Americans I also want to talk about are the Virginia people, because the people of the Powhatan tribes were, again, some of the first to be contacted by English people, John Smith and the colonists in Virginia. So they too took captives, and they took Pocahontas. And she was another person that had her image made, not by an English person, but by a Dutch-trained artist. And I think this whole question of how Dutch art feeds into English art is really important, because Dutch art had a huge influence on English art in the 17th and 18th centuries. So her portrait as a courtier, as a person of high rank, is here on your left. But if you look at her face and you look at the bronzino, how closely the pattern of the nose, the pattern of the eyebrows, the pattern of the lips, the shading, is very, very similar. That is where visual culture feeds into her image. This artist is looking to the great Renaissance past, the great artists of that earlier period that they wanted to emulate. And they can't help it. They're artists. That's what they do. So she is anglicized. She is made more European by this. But if we contrast her face with some of the earlier white drawings, you can see that Pocahontas also has Algonquin features. There are aspects of her that you can see that she carries some of the features. So it's always this tug between the reality of what the artist sees, what he's trying or she is trying to record, and the visual culture and the graphic culture of that period. So also, I wanted to contrast some other Algonquin faces. These are John White in the center, an older man, the chief called Wingina of Virginia, and Pocahontas, who was just a few decades later, and then Wenceslas Hollar's drawing, which you have in reproduction here in the Bradfordton exhibit. And you can see that Algonquin faces have this quality and that they are consistent. If you look at the head and the plucked scalp and the raised pattern of the hair, that is consistent through several generations, even though these are two separate peoples. These are coastal Algonquins and Delaware. That's a Munsee Indian. So it's so interesting that when you put images together, they do speak to each other. They really do. Okay, now we have to jump forward a little bit into the 18th century. This is where I've done a lot more work, and these four men, very, very important for English diplomacy and English aspirations to empire. Essentially, the entire 18th century is a fight with the French to control the North American continent, and the Iroquois are the people, the Haudenosaunee, the people of the Longhouse, are the people that are going to be crucial to whether that goes one way or the other. So these men were brought over to London, and they had their portraits painted by John Verelst. Now, the Verelst family of painters are only just being studied now. Can you believe that? In England, they have a Center for 18th Century Studies at York University. They are doing the catalogs. They are looking now at the Verelsts. They've been very shadowy people. There's a whole family of painters. John Verelst and his son William Verelst, who we're going to talk about later, were trained as in the Dutch tradition. So if you remember what I said about the Dutch being a particular influence on English art at this time. So we have not all of these four portraits in the exhibition. We have Brandt on the very end with the beautiful tattoo on the chest. And we have the third man from the left, Tetaini Hogui, and he is the leader of the delegation holding the wampum. So what I want to say about this is that Verelst, being a Dutch-trained artist, although he is English, he was born in England, he has that Dutch sensibility. That is a sensibility about detail. The Dutch tradition has always been considered too naturalistic. In other words, oh, they paint everything. They paint people like they actually look. If you think about Rembrandt and some of his attitudes about the face and how, as he aged, Rembrandt studied himself very closely, that Dutch art tends to have these qualities. So here is a Dutch, probably speaking artist, he probably still can speak Dutch, speaking to people who probably also can speak Dutch. In other words, the Mohican men in this delegation may have been able to speak Dutch, and they believe that Taney Hogewin, who is the man in the dark coat and the red, he also could speak Dutch because he was Christianized. So why would a Dutch painter study tattooing as a faith in the face if he wasn't interested in the detail? So my view is that let's look at it too. Maybe we can find out more about why those tattoos were so carefully made. There has been some speculation about the tattooing. Some people say that it's entirely made up. There's nobody else that's ever been tattooed like this. Other people say that this mark across the lips was a tide mark for people in case they went over the water, they would survive, they wouldn't drown. Something of that, you know, which is very speculative and not proven. So I'm just very, very curious about the tattooing, which appears on almost all of the paintings in this period. So the 1710 people made a big impact on the British. They were wined and dined, they were presented at court to Queen Anne, and so all the later delegations who came in the 18th century to Britain also had this same treatment, brought to court, shown the military, shown the might of England. A lot of money was spent on them, and they were aware of this. But the other aspect is that people wanted to see them. People wanted to get a glimpse of these exotic people who they'd never seen before. You can understand that. If they heard about America, they heard about the indigenous people, what do they look like? How do they behave? Can they talk? Do they wear clothes? So a lot of these delegates were clothed. And if you think about the Mohawk delegation, they wouldn't have worn clothes like that. These were given to them from the theater to be able to dress them according to the courtly tradition. But guess what we find when we see that in the next delegation in 1730, the Cherokee group that come, they too are given the clothing of the courtier, and guess what we see? The same elbow in the man on the second from the left, Catrigusta. So this is like becoming a trope now. This is becoming the way to present Native Americans in this time. And it gives the impression that the men were graceful and the men carried themselves well. And all of the reports, when you read the reports, the courtly journals, the Daily Courant, the Daily Journal, these people behaved well. They didn't speak when they didn't speak out of turn, they didn't question the king, particularly King George was very impressed with these guys. He said, I thought they behaved marvelously. So this plays very oddly with the idea of uncivilized. It doesn't go along with that. So we have a kind of a strange disjunction between people that are supposed to run around naked and be very scary, and also their behavior at court. So I don't think the English understood. They didn't know who they were seeing in the first place. Many times they were called kings. If you see the little quotation, seven kings or chiefs of the Cherokees Indians bordering upon Caroline are come to pay their duty to His Majesty King George II and assure him of their attachment to his person and government. I think it's really interesting that groups like this came, they gave wampum, which was a very serious exchange, and they gave eagle feathers, which is again a very serious exchange. It means a commitment, an agreement, a treaty in their terms. And those were treaties that some of the people still hold to. They've never been broken. In other words, when you give wampum, like the Mohawks did, they brought wampum. They say that treaty still holds. That's 1710. And when I had an exhibition in London and I showed these four portraits in 2007, we had a delegate come from the Mohawk Nation and presented exactly that. He said, "We need help. We still honor this treaty. You're still our allies." So it's very interesting, the nature of agreement, the nature of treaties, looking at them from different perspectives. So the Cherokees, too, had treaties. And this is just to identify the people. I realize that these are not Cherokees. recognizable words. What they are things that the English recorders wrote down. So Una Panoa, Skalikasen, or Ketagusta, these are all titles. They're honorifics, they're not personal names. And if you know any native people today, any traditional people, they are very, you know, they don't like giving personal names. It's a tradition. So so these groups too had that same wariness about giving all their power away and with a name. So these were all young men. They weren't the leaders, they weren't the kings, they were men representing others back at home. And this whole delegation was set up by a Scotsman called Sir Alexander Cumming, who really took it upon himself as a traitor to go to the Cherokee in 1729 and make a treaty with them. So that's pretty bold. And so he brought these men to the court, not really knowing what was going to happen, but luckily all things went pretty well. So that is a preamble for the kinds of things that went on for this delegation, which is the kind of the main one I want to talk about. And the painting, which is now on show at the DeWitt Wallace, just across there. You can see it there. There's no glass over it. It's amazing. You know, you really get to look at it. And I spent a lot of time with this picture. It didn't get into my book, unfortunately, but I would so love to write more about it. It's really at an apex of when the British and the Native Americans were working together, when they formed the colony of Georgia. And this colony is very special at this time. I don't know if you know the history of Georgia, but it was started as a colony to help people get out of debt. One of the worst things that happened in England was when soldiers came back from war and they had no jobs, sound familiar, and they're out of work, they end up in debt, and then they get put in debtor's prison. There are people who fought for their country, and they end up in debtor's prison. Well, Oglethorpe, General James Oglethorpe, was also a military man. He saw one of his best friends put into prison, into debtor's prison, and suffer. This is a painting by Hogarth. I'm sorry, it's so really not very good. I took with my phone in the National Portrait Gallery in London just a few weeks ago. But it shows a young Oglethorpe on the left pleading for a man who is a Sephardic Jewish man in debt. He'd been put in manacles for days. And, you know, this just was so inhumane. And he was arguing with this new committee that Parliament set up, the jail committee, to look at the conditions of the jails. So these are times of humanitarianism, times when the body of the British intelligentsia, which is really what you see here represented, these are people like the Earl of Shaftesbury, who wrote a book on aesthetics. He's in the very far left. If you look up the very far left, the man at the very top of those three heads is Anthony Ashley Cooper, the second Earl of Shaftesbury, who is the man that this painting was dedicated to. And in the center of the picture is Oglethorpe, and he's greeting the Creek delegation of 1734 in, I think it's in Whitehall myself. I think that it's not the Georgia Trustee rooms. I think because of the nature of the room, it's very grand. Also, you can see Westminster Abbey out the window. So this, if you look at the picture, you can see that it's this grand room. It's almost dwarfing the people. But there's something about this picture that really intrigues me. It's the balance of it. It's the order of it. The way that those men all look in one direction as if they're sort of one mind. And they're forming the Georgia colony before you. They're almost telling you, this is what we're doing, and we're going to help the indigenous people, we're going to work with them, we're going to Christianize, which is certainly part of the whole process. And the little boy in the very center is the key to the picture. He sort of hinges, everything hinges around him. This is Tuanahoe, who you have the beautiful little drawing over in the DeWitt also that's next to the big picture that is also in the collections here. He was taught English already before he got to London, and he could read from the Bible. He was very clever, and he became a huge interpreter for the Creek at this time. But if you look at that circle of hands around him, and you think about that, the ways that art can symbolize, you you know, he was the future. He was the hope for this colony in being able to help the Native people to work together with the British. I've looked at some of the detail on the regalia of the figures, and it's very clear that he had studied regalia. You can see one of those garter ties. That's from the British Museum, I think. And they don't look exactly like what you see, but they're certainly what Varel wanted to look at and to describe. But also, what else do you see in the poses? What else do you find when you look at the indigenous people? The same elbow. It's got to be there. And this time it really is pointing right out at you. And so it's almost like the artist can't let go of this. But then when you think about who this artist is, this is William Varel's, the son of John Varel. So John Varel's father painted these pictures, John Varel's. And this is 1710. The next generation paints this picture. So there's a kind of handing on of Indian painting from one generation to the next. And the kinds of qualities that this picture has, just briefly, if you could do a mathematical analysis, a kind of almost a golden section. Do you know what the golden section is? It's that wonderful proportion we find in nature that is the spiral in a conch shell. There's something going on in this picture that's the golden section. I'm almost sure of it. And if I was clever enough, I would do an analysis. But the Native American proportion is almost in proportion with it's one third, and then the other picture's two thirds. So there's this beautiful balance going on, which I think shows how intensely artists thought about this. And as I mentioned, there's a drawing in the DeWitt of Tuanahoy, as well as the Metzitint engraving of Tomochachi, the leader of the delegates, who really was someone like Oglethorpe. I mean, they were kind of a weird pairing of people that saw beyond the now. They saw into the future. What could we do here? What could we create here? And he too was a bit of an outcast. He was not part of the Creek Confederacy as such, but he made a lot of overtures, and so they did include him back in the Confederacy as a representative. So he was able to bring the Creek nations together to be able to work with the British, at least for the time. So I mentioned the tattooing, and I mentioned how Varel had studied it, and I thought quite carefully to maybe get an accurate rendition. Well, it looks like his son Willem also studied the tattooing, and you can see on the chest of Tomochachi that he too has this pattern, which seems consistent with warriors who have had active service, sort of like the epaulets and the medals on soldiers in our culture. These are the signs of their distinction, that they are leaders. But also on the Tomochachi's face, if you look on the side of his face, there's a little bit of a squiggly line that looks like it, or it goes like that. I've read in some of the accounts that people would have a tattoo when you had toothache, and it would take the pain out of your system. So this could be a thing that he observed, or it could be something he read and put into the portrait. It's hard to tell. But on the right is a portrait of the Prince of Wales, George III. And so he's the upcoming prince. Here's Tuanahoy with his young prince. Tomochachi and Tuanahoy. But they're in the same pose. I mean, essentially, Tomochachi is in a king pose, like George III, or who would be George III. So, moving on, I don't want to take all the time up, but we have a few more delegations to talk about, and one of the next ones is a very exciting time in 1762, when another group of Cherokee people came. There were four people originally, and unfortunately, they had an interpreter, and he died on the voyage, and that's the man you see in the very far left, who looks sort of shadowy and kind of strange. He was apparently, there was some talk as though he was poisoned, but that's not been proved. So that really hurt this delegation because they didn't have the interpreters that some of the other delegations had in 1730 and 1734. So this group were engraved. Here, this is a print that circulated probably much more commonly than any other image of this time. And I think there's an example of this in the Colonial Williamsburg collection, so you've got one here. But what's familiar? What do you think is familiar? What do you see that opposes? There's not quite the Renaissance, but they come directly from Varel's, from the original, I shouldn't. But if you see this man on the far left there, Teyana Hongui, he's got his hand on his hip, he's holding wampum, and that was engraved as a mezzotint. So it's available for artists to take that. And I'll have that, I'll take that like a magpie and put it into this one and make it make sense. Because these were seen as chiefs, as kings, as rulers of their people, so they too were given the same kinds of poses. And they were dressed in courtly style because this was the way delegates were presented. They've even given him the wolf figure, which is the little dog at the side of his feet. So everything's included. But they came from Cherokee country. They've been contacted by Lieutenant Henry Timberlake, who you may know some of the history of this, but there was the wars of the 1761 with the Cherokees. There was a lot of decimation in the towns, but eventually peace was reached and the treaty was signed. So they wanted to bring some of the headmen over to London and I think the headmen wanted to come, but they couldn't. They were too powerful, they were too important. So they sent the younger men, which is sort of the pattern. So we have younger men coming instead of the leaders. So I don't want to question the identities of who these people are. It's very, very difficult. There was, at this time, also a huge print culture in England that loved to make fun. And they made fun of everybody. They made fun of the kings, they made fun of the princes. Gilray, I don't know if you know the satirist Gilray, he's always making fun of people. So what this is sort of a satire broadsheet called A New Humorous Song on the Cherokee Chiefs. So it sort of gives you the other side. The people were, they were unaware really of who these people were. They didn't understand what they meant and why they were here. They knew that a treaty was being signed, but they also wanted to make fun, because that's another way of dispelling fear, dispelling misunderstanding. So they made a song about Cherokee kisses. And there was always that sort of tantalizing, that flirtation with these delegates. So also, there were engravings of the next portraits that I'm going to talk about. One, the portrait we have here of Punashote by Francis Parsons in 1762. He probably was the leader of the delegation. He has the kind of name, Nishote, that signifies him as stalking turkey as a leadership role. So I found this very interesting because he too has a tattoo on his throat. And it looks almost like it's a sort of choker or medal. It's, and if you look at the center image, that's an image by Trumbull, John Trumbull, of an Oneida chief, and he too has that similar. Now, the one in the center is 1792, so it's quite a bit later than this. So are these two images talking to each other? And the medals are probably one of the most distinctive things. I think that Duane King is doing some work on this, so I don't want to talk over that. But I found the medals very interesting because you can't identify them. The one on the left is a Queen Anne medal. And on the back it says entirely English. And I thought that's interesting to give that to a Native American person. Apparently Queen Anne said, in the course of a speech to two houses of Parliament on the 11th of March, she addressed them saying, "As I know my own heart to be entirely English, I can very sincerely assure you that there's not anything you can expect or desire from me which I shall not be ready to do for the happiness and prosperity of England." Sounds a bit like Theresa May, I was going to say. Enough of that. And so So these are very important individuals because what they represent with the medals, with the gorget, is their loyalty to the crown, their loyalty to King George III, their ability to put troops on the ground when needed. But at the same time, as I say, people were aware of that importance, but they were also aware that these people were different. They didn't speak English. There was no translator to tell us, you know, who they were really. And I don't know why Timberlake didn't help out. I mean, he wrote a book, but I don't know why he wasn't there to help translate. But. So I wanted to mention about the silver. The silver in the fur trade is hugely important, and I think it's one of those things that, again, symbolizes connection. It symbolizes the connection of the people with trade, that they needed the trade. And you can see from that description below, from a table of goods and the prices, that a silver breastplate cost 9 pounds of skin, and a silver breastplate that was engraved cost 12 pounds of skin. So they weren't easy objects to obtain, and those that got them were very proud to wear them. And there were all kinds of forms of trade silver. The crescent-shaped gorgets did come from uniforms worn by British Army officers, but they also are protective. I mean, they're about protection of the throat area. So in British culture, they have that symbolic role, but also in Native American culture, they were also worn at points on the body which were considered weak points, where you could get hurt, you could get killed, and so putting silver there protected you. Native people honored silver as a beautiful substance, like we all do. It's beautiful when it's burnished and shiny, and the luminosity was particularly powerful. So Native people wore silver. So you see silver on all the men. You see it really beautifully displayed. Kunashote's silver on his arms and the huge breastplate. But also on the other man, who has been called Skia Kustuka, on some of the portraits, but we were looking, Buck and I, and Danielle and I, and we think that it actually says Skia Gust, which is actually a Cherokee name. Skia Gusta is a leader, a warrior, I think, is that right? So it's interesting that Reynolds, Sir Joshua Reynolds, who painted Skia Gust Uka, did hear the right name and did put the right name on the portrait. And he too wears a gorget. It's not exactly like the one that you see illustrated here. This is a George III gorget. This one is much more decorated. So it may signify that he was a special leader of his own, and certainly some of the people thought that the man on the right, Skia Gusta, was the leader. But from my research, I feel that the younger man, Kunashote, was the actual leader of the delegation. And he's much more strongly represented. If you think about the contrast between the two portraits, his image is very memorable, and Reynolds, Sir Joshua Reynolds' image, maybe it's because of his style, is a little bit harder to kind of quantify. There's something sort of difficult about identifying who this is, I think. So you can see the contrast in styles. Reynolds was the leading portrait artist of his time. He painted all of the gentry, although the king didn't particularly patronize him. All of the others did really love Reynolds. And the style of Reynolds is the growing new style of art and romanticism. So it's sort of leaving behind the harder, defined outlines of the earlier period. And I put this in because it's getting toward the end of the century, and this woman who was depicted by Joseph Wright of Derby is meant to be a Cherokee Indian widow. It was called the Indian Widow. And Joseph Wright of Derby had never met or seen a Native American, but he read lots of texts about them, and he read about the women and their devotion to the warriors, and how they would sit out for nights on end in horrific climates. And I think in his mind, I think he was picturing Hawaii or somewhere with a huge volcano going on. But on the plains, I mean, women did mourn, and some of the things were about cutting themselves, cutting their hair. There's even evidence that some of the Native American people would cut digits off their fingers when they lost people. And yeah, it's a really intense experience. So I think the British artist here was trying to get that sense of drama, and you you know, that she might die out there in nature next to the trophies of her husband. So there was still this romanticism growing, and at the very end of the century, the last delegation I'm going to talk about is a Creek and Cherokee delegation to London, which was not sponsored by the Crown. It did not have the authority. It was coming from a man called Rio Augustus Bowles, and he is a very prominent person in Turkey and Creek history, presenting himself as a commander-in-chief, trying to get support from the Crown. And he had his portrait painted by Thomas Hardy, which is now in Upton House. And you can see that style of Reynolds, which is becoming so much more prominent, the soft background, the moodiness, the concentration on maybe the spirit or soul of the sitter, you know, much, much more. And alongside Bowles, three other men came, and one of them may have been a Creek man, but some of them are only identified as a Cherokee man. They were commissioned by the man who was running the College of Surgeons, and he, Dr. Hunter, wanted a collection of images of different types of people. And you can see the growing interest in the idea of racialism, that there are certain types of people. And so they wanted good examples, and so this delegation turned up, and Hunter said, well, I'll have some images of them. But it's the qualities of the art that these faces look to me as the most real, the most interesting, and if you like, indigenous faces of the Cherokee man that came along. This is Moses Price, probably, who we can identify, wearing a gorget. And these men, too, fought in the field for British forces. They wanted to support the British in a kind of maybe a takeover of the South. Again, they had this idea that they could make another great empire in the South, kick Spain out, and, you know, really fantastic ideas that were to come to nothing. In fact, Bowles ended up in a prison in Havana. I think that's where he died. He was an adventurer and maybe a bit of a flake, too. Don't know exactly the history. But finally, there was a big picture that was painted in 1792 at the time that this delegation was in London. This is the Rotunda of the Bank of England. This was painted for the Polish Prince Stanislaus, and it shows the Polish royal family. But among all the people, here are two Cherokee figures. And this is sort of to show the sort of reduction of the idea of the delegates to just color and exoticism within the London scene. That there was this kind of coming away of the power and the interest that was given to, say, the delegation of 1734 when Thomas Chachi came, and having distinguished painters like Louis Burrell's. And I think that the one picture that this really reminds me of and that it may have influenced is this painting by Benjamin West, which is the Penn's Treaty with the Indians of 1770s. And it, too, shows this, if you like, block of Anglo or Dutch Anglo men who are founding Pennsylvania. And so they too have that kind of one mind and one purpose. And the native people are shown very almost individually. And I think that it has a lot of resonance with this one, that indigenous people, I think they recognized that they were individual, that they did had this quality, that they could stand for themselves, that they weren't just a representative, that they had qualities and accomplishments, and that they were distinguished. And so here in this picture, you see all the different faces. They look very distinctive. You look at the English side, and you've just got this sea of wigs, you know, and it's like, so it sort of dominates, and yet it recedes. And what comes out in this picture is the liveliness, the vitality, the significance of Tomochachi. And this too, Penn and his quiet Quakers receive that, and out comes these colorful, individual, vital people that are making peace with the English. And I'm going to leave it at that.
Thank you.